Good evening and welcome to Q&A. I'm Tony Jones. Answering your questions tonight, the Deputy Opposition Leader, Tanya Plibersek, leading broadcaster, Alan Jones, Professor of Indigenous Studies, Marcia Langton, Finance Minister, Mathias Cormann, and leading economic analyst, Chris Richardson. Please welcome our panel. So, as usual, you can watch Q&A live across Australia on ABC TV, News 24, and listen on News Radio. And we're streaming Q&A live via Facebook. Well, the Brexit shock is already having an impact on the federal election campaign here. Let's go to our first question. It's from Ivan Lung.
Hi, everyone. So with the increase in the level of uncertainty and volatility in global markets stemming from this Brexit, how do you see this affecting budget projections?
Okay, I'm sorry, Ivan, we've just got a bit of a sound problem, I'm told, so we're going to have to quickly grab a new microphone and come back in over your head. And here it comes now. Okay, we could hear it here, but people at home couldn't, so go ahead.
Hi, everyone. So with the increase in the level of uncertainty and volatility in global markets stemming from the Brexit, how do you see this affecting budget projections in terms of government expenditure and tax revenue? And also, are you willing to push the budget further into deficit if needed, if the economy requires stimulus?
Okay, before we go to the stimulus part of it, let's hear from Chris Richardson first, our economist. What sort of fallout could result from Brexit?
Look, I'm hopeful that it won't be bad. I think the politics are bigger than the economics, and there's a risk that both of them get worse from here. But if it is just the UK leaving the European Union, that's not enough, I think, to be a major problem. You know, families, businesses in the UK, they'll be more worried, they'll not spend as much, that'll hurt their economy. But probably not enough to put them into recession, and they're only 4% of the world anyway. Not enough, I think, to put the EU into recession, and not enough to make a big difference here. If you have a nasty thing, a recession, you should do stimulus. But this, what we've seen from Brexit, I'm hopeful, is horror headlines, but not a particular hit to our economy.
Mathias Cormann.
Well, at any one point in time, as an open trading economy, what happens in the rest of the world matters to us. What is important is that Australia is in the strongest possible position to deal with any global economic headwinds, to deal with any external risks that we have to deal with from time to time. That is, of course, why it is so important that we keep implementing our plan for jobs and growth. That is why it is so important that we continue to do the work to put the budget on the strongest possible foundation for the future. One of our key criticisms of our competition in this election is that by pursuing bigger deficits, higher taxes, it actually would hurt our economy and it would hurt investment and cost jobs. And it would be the wrong way to go for our economy, whereas what we need is a continuation of our comprehensive economic plan for jobs and growth, a continuation of our efforts to put our budget back on a sustainable foundation for the future.
Mathias, do you agree, however, with Chris Richardson's point that the threat of Brexit affecting our economy is somewhat exaggerated?
Well, I mean, obviously, I leave it to others to provide the commentary, but in terms of our assessment of it, at any one point in time, the Australian economy has to deal with factors in the global economy. I mean, this is one factor. There are a whole range of other factors. I mean, if you look at what's happened in the global economy in recent times, certainly the Australian economy has had to deal with lower global economic growth. We've had to deal with significantly lower global prices for our key commodity exports. That's had a flow-on impact on our economy. So what we've been doing is we've been focusing on making sure that we are as competitive internationally as possible, as productive as possible, that we're in the best possible position and in the most resilient position possible to deal with any challenges coming our way, but also in the best possible position to take advantage of opportunities in the Asia Pacific, which is where most of the global economic growth will be generated for years and decades to come.
Tanya Plibersek.
Well, thanks for the question. Bill Shorten has said that he'd like me to go to Britain and to Europe if we're elected, as my first trip as Foreign Minister, to speak firsthand with people who will give us an analysis of the likely effects for the European economy as well as the British economy. But there's a couple of things I'd say about Australia's position. The first is we all hope that there isn't an effect on Australia's economy, or at least not a large effect. But if there is, the very last people you would trust to be in charge are the same mob who actually argued against taking action during the global financial crisis. We saved the Australian economy from going into recession, like many comparable economies. We saved 200,000 people from losing their jobs. We won 3 AAA credit ratings for the first time in Australia's history. We actually grew the Australian economy while the rest of the world was going into recession. That's the sort of leadership and that's the sort of economic management you would want if there was uncertainty. The second thing I'd say about Brexit is there are many people speculating about the reasons for this, but I would say at least one of the reasons is one of the things that's driving the volatility in Britain, but also the sort of political volatility that we're seeing in the United States, and that's the growing wealth gap in many countries. And sadly, we see that growing wealth gap in Australia as well. We've got inequality at 75-year highs. We've got stagnant wages growth. Wages growth is running at about 2.1%, which is the lowest on record. We've got the three wealthiest Australians owning as much as the million poorest Australians. The way that we need to tackle that is to, yes, pay down debt over time, but to continue to invest in health, in education, to make sure that we've got a strong economy generating good quality jobs. We've lost 50,000 full-time jobs since the beginning of the year. Employers, business confidence is low, consumer confidence is low, business investment is low. And when employers are putting people on, they're putting them on part-time or casual because of that low confidence.
Can I just interrupt you just for a moment there? I mean, you, in the first part of your answer, you talked about the fact that you'd be prepared for stimulus if necessary. But have you left yourself as a government, if you ever got into government, or if you got into government after this election, have you left any wriggle room with all the spending? Because you've got deficits going out right through each year of government.
Well, I actually wasn't talking about stimulus in response to Brexit. I was saying that last time we had uncertain economic times, the worst times in 75 years, we had an opposition that voted against taking action. We had a shadow treasurer at the time, Julie Bishop, who said we should sit and wait and see in response to the global financial crisis. Mathias, a minute ago, was talking about global headwinds and the downturn in commodity prices. We faced the global financial crisis, the worst economic circumstances in 75 years.
Okay, I'm sorry.
And we came through that much better than most other comparable countries.
I'm going to interrupt you there to go on to Alan Jones.
Well, Tony, thank you. I welcome Chris's comments. Look, and thank you for your question, simply because it's a manifestation of what's gone on in the last couple of days. We've got a lot of alarmist nonsense here. All that has happened is there's been a vote. That's all that's happened. Nothing else has happened. This is not the collapse of Lehman Brothers, where the whole world went mad and lost a lot of money. This is a vote. And Article 50 is not likely to be implemented within the next couple of years. And what we've seen here is, of course, the money markets having a big whinge because, of course, they lost money. The same money markets that backed the Stay In, the Remain campaign and made quite a bit of money out of it. There's been a correction to those markets. All that has happened, and it's very disturbing that media, sections of the media and of the money markets have created this alarmist notion that some Armageddon is upon us. All that's happened is people voted to stay out of the European Union, which I have to say, has been brought on by the European Union, which is a bloated, bureaucratic, expensive, inefficient, ineffective outfit, and where the Brits said, and I've just got a note here from, took this off social media today, an airport worker said, I've no GP, as they're all full in my area, I can't get onto the housing ladder, I've got three kids in one room, the place where I grew up once was a lovely area, but it's now a no-go zone, how is the EU and uncontrolled immigration working for me, a 40-year-old Brit who's been working full-time since the age of 16? I mean, people were angry about the way in which they were being ignored by this bureaucratic, monolithic outfit in Brussels, and they've simply said, listen, not for us. But that's all that's happened. There's just been a vote. Whatever happens beyond that will be something that nations will be able to adjust and accommodate, and I think it's business as usual. Now, the money markets oughtn't to be allowed to dictate attitudes and command the headlines which they have because they've lost a few bob. Well, they got their fingers burnt because they backed the wrong horse. Now they're trying to pretend that they're a little bit dirty because they've lost some money. So I just think that your question, which I'm grateful for, is a manifestation of the fact that many people think something grand is happening when all that's happened is a vote has occurred. And I think you'll find the appropriate correction will occur and life will go on. It'll be much better for the POMs. I mean, the pound has gone down. My God, Glenn Stevens would love that to happen to our currency. if something could reduce the currency, they'll suddenly be able to export.
Very briefly, Alan, it doesn't sound like you'd be at all surprised that John Howard today endorsed the Brexit vote.
Quite, yes, I endorse it thoroughly, I have to tell you.
Mm. OK, Marcia Langton.
Your question, and thank you for that, is whether or not it will have an impact on the Australian economy. I mean, obviously, our finance minister is right. Our major trading partners are in the Asia-Pacific area and the United States. We're not a part of the EU. What will, I think, be a problem in the long term is whether or not Europe breaks up. So we had, you know, Grexit. Now we've got Brexit. Will we have Nexit? And I think that will present some problems politically. So, you know, that those kinds of tectonic shifts in, you know, national politics, sovereignty politics, I think will have a security impact. And how the world responds to that in the next couple of years is very, very important. So Australia should be worried about that. Is the Chinese government worried about Brexit? Not particularly, from what I've read. I think somebody, one of the Chinese economists said there'll be some instability for the next 5 years, but it's nothing we can't handle. And, you know, I think that should be our attitude too. We're not directly involved. It's caused a downturn in commodity prices. That's a problem for us. Will they go back up? Probably, you know, everything's starting to calm down today. I think it's really a rumble in Europe that is a very, very long way away from us. Will it affect our markets? A little bit. Will it affect security? Yes. Will it affect attitudes? Yes. So, you know, people around the world but will be, as I see Alan is, enlivened to say, isn't it, you know, wonderful that we got our lives back from those horrible people from overseas? That's a problem.
Let's move on to our next question. We'll come back to some of those issues later. The question is from Gordon to Catelby.
Both Labor and Liberal have promised to get the budget back to surplus between 2020 and 2026. 2021 and 2026. Our budgets or our deficit situation not out of control, requiring meaningful attention by both parties instead of fiddling at the edges as they are both doing at this time?
Mathias Cormann, you're promising surplus in 2020, I guess, between 2020 and 21.
Well, when we came into government in September 2013, we inherited a weakening economy, rising unemployment and a budget position that was rapidly deteriorating on the back of unsustainable spending promises that had been made by our predecessors. Today, our economy is stronger, growing at 3.1% instead of 2%. The employment growth is stronger, running at three times the rate over the last 12 months compared to the last 12 months of the previous government. The unemployment rate at 5.7% is below where it had previously been anticipated. And we are getting the spending growth trajectory that we inherited from our predecessors under control. Instead of going to spending as a share of the economy of 26.5% by 23-24, we have been able to... we inherited a growing spending growth trajectory in terms of spending as a share of the economy. We've been able to stop the growth, and we are projected to bring that down to about 25.2% over the forward estimates. And we've done that by making sure that the policy decisions we're making are actually improving the budget bottom line. The net effect of our policy decisions, wherever we've had to spend more money, we've been able to pay for that with spending reductions in other parts of the budget. And now, if you compare that with the alternative, the announcements that they've made in recent days, not as a result of external factors, not as a result of changes in economic conditions, not as a result of what happened in the global economy, but as a result of spending promises, as a result of decisions that the Labor Party has made, they're proposing to increase the size of the deficit over the next 4 years by $16.5 billion. In fact, they're proposing to deteriorate, to have a worse bottom line over seven out of the next 11 years. So what we're saying is we're now making progress heading in the right direction. The budget is now on a credible path back to surplus by 2020-21.
Just on that surplus issue, there's a good deal of scepticism about the Treasury forecasts you're relying on to rein in the deficit and reach surplus. Treasury projections for the last 4 years were out by $140 billion. What happens if they're wrong again?
Well, you know, obviously, when we came into government, the global price for our key commodity exports, which is iron ore, was sitting at about $120 a tonne. Nobody predicted that it would go down as low as, you know, in the mid-30s.
But that's... Mathias Cormann, isn't that the problem? If the Treasury has such problem forecasting, aren't you in trouble trying to reach your surplus if their forecasts are wrong?
Well, there's a difference. You've got to make a difference between the things that are outside of your control that would happen irrespective of who is in government. What happened to global prices for our iron ore exports or coal exports or LNG exports, that would have happened irrespective of who is in government. What we control is the policy...
That's what Wayne Swan used to say, if you don't mind me making that point.
What we control are the decisions that we make. And the decisions that we've made since we came into government have improved the budget bottom line. The decisions that we're putting forward as part of our plan in this budget are improving the budget bottom line. Labor, this is not me saying it. Bill Shorten, Chris Bowen, Tony Burke, they've been saying... They've admitted that the decisions that they're making deteriorate the budget.
Before I go to you, I know you want to jump in and I can see why, I just want to hear from the economist Chris Richardson first. And let's go back to the question about the deficit being out of control. Are the deficits out of control, or do you see that everything's going to come good by 2020?
Look, they're not out of control, but they are absolutely not fixed. We genuinely have a problem as a nation here. And it comes down to four words: temporary boom, permanent promises. The China boom, the resources boom, was magnificent for the budget. You know, the biggest beneficiary wasn't the miners, it wasn't Western Australia, it was the tax man in Canberra. And the money came and the money went, but while the money was around, you know, we made all these promises to ourselves. The family benefits, the baby bonuses, national disability insurance scheme, Gonski, 8 personal income tax cuts, in a row. And our political system is absolutely struggling to turn that around. We made ourselves promises that are too big. And after that, it's not even economics, it's maths. At some stage, if you want a better budget, and you should, because it would protect you in the next recession, if you want a better budget, you have to cut spending and or raise taxes. And I'd say do both. I'm happy to see the bulk of the effort done on spending. But it is a problem. You know, yes, we're all reliant on those official figures that come out of Treasury, but you've got to understand what they do and don't include. Labor made the correct comment yesterday that there's a bunch of zombie measures in there that aren't going to get through. And my fear
worth.
Is that's right.
Shrinking, has been shrinking during the campaign.
$30 billion worth.
You're backing significantly more than at the beginning of the campaign.
OK, well, we'll save this argument. We'd want to hear from the expert first if we can. And Chris, can I just jump in on you? You've now seen the costings and the projections from both major parties. Have they accounted for the big ticket funding items that are coming down the track? NDIS, hospitals, health, defence spending among them. So coming in, many of them into their biggest phase of spending around 2020, when both sides are promising a surplus.
And we've made really expensive promises to ourselves that do get more expensive. And our problem is that zombie measures would exist whoever is in government, because whoever is in opposition is not giving the breathing space to the government of the day. And that, you know, so to me, if you ask me, what was the biggest single thing you could do to get better budgets in Australia? You could break what is now a 20-year trend. Both sides in opposition have been increasingly willing to be opportunist, to be populist. And that inability to grant a mandate, to say, you know, kind of, OK, there needs to be some bipartisanship on something. If you don't get compromise in Canberra, you don't get some of the budget repair that we need.
OK, Tanya Plibersek.
So, the Liberals have tripled the deficit next year. Well, you predicted a deficit of $10.9 billion for next year, and it's about $28, $29 billion next year.
Our policy decisions are improving.
$37 billion next year. then they've added $100 billion to net debt. So net debt will be around $326 billion next year.
Less than it would have been under Labor.
They've, the $30 billion worth of zombie measures make it, the headline figures are actually worse. We are never going to agree to raising the pension age to 70. We are never going to agree to some of the measures that are in that list, cutting family tax benefits and so on. The centrepiece of the Liberals' so-called economic plan is a $50 billion unfunded tax cut for big business. $30 billion of that goes straight overseas to overseas shareholders, and a $16 billion tax cut for people on $180,000 a year or more. Over the next 10 years, we will actually improve the budget bottom line by $10.5 billion more, even though, yes, we will spend more on education, and yes, we will spend more on health, and yes, we will spend more on infrastructure. We think of those as productive investments that will have payoffs, not just for individuals who benefit from a better education, but for our nation. We cannot be an innovation nation, as the Prime Minister likes to say, without being an education nation. That's why we invest in education.
Okay. All right. Tanya, I'm going to get to the... Take about another 30 seconds if you can.
Well, so the Liberals' unfunded $66 billion of tax cuts mean that by year 10 of our forward projections, their $50 billion tax cut on its own will be costing the budget $14 billion a year every year. In contrast, we've made a structural change. Just one example, the negative gearing and capital gains tax changes will mean an improvement in 10 years' time, an improvement to the budget of $8 billion every year in that 10th year. So $14 billion unfunded tax giveaway versus $8 billion improvement through our capital gains tax and negative gearing. That's one change. We've outlined $130 okay. billion dollars of
All right.
improvements
I'm,
to the
I'm
budget.
I'm going to pass to Alan Jones rather than trying to interrogate that.
Well, yep. I think the questioner has asked what is central, ought to be central to the campaign and isn't. The reality is the interest on our debt is costing us $1.2 billion a month. That's $40 million a day. That's a brand new primary school every 8 hours. Now, I think both political parties are letting us down. They ought to come together, forget the Senate, which will be obstructionist no matter what anybody does. Surely to God, both major parties can come together and say, this has to be addressed in defence of our children of tomorrow. It's this notion about intergenerational debt. How the hell can we allow ourselves to spend all of this money that the questioner has alluded to and leave the kids to pay it off? Let me give you an example. And, Mathias, I'm sorry, this is not flattering for the government. But if you take the forward estimates, the expenditure over these... That's the next 4 years. In the budget brought down, $1,800 billion. What has the government done about that? They have said they'll retire $1.7 billion. That's 0.09% of expenditure. I mean, really, it's your finger in the dike. And today, there's been all this carry-on about the Labor Party increasing the debt over the forward estimates by $16 billion. Now, the government says they're going to live within their means, but they have increased expenditure in the last budget, and over the forward estimates will add $85 billion to the debt. Now they're complaining about Labor saying, well, we're going to add another $16 billion. The other $16 billion isn't even 1% of the total expenditure over the 4 years, 0.86%. The issue here is to say, if we are going to spend $1,800 billion over 4 years, surely to God we can seriously address cutting expenditure so that we're not spending $1.2 billion a month on interest, $40 million a day, a primary school every 8 hours. I don't think either political party is serious on the critical issue that the questioner posed.
I'm going to quickly go back to Mathias Cormann. Are you prepared, if it becomes apparent that you need to cut deeply into spending? Or, alternatively, as Chris Richardson said, another option, raise revenue?
Well, our budget is our plan, and it sets it all out. And you know, we are bringing the budget back to surplus in a way that is credible and that is responsible. Now,
but how do you respond to the series of facts that were just put to you that the difference between you and Labor is minimal?
Well, firstly, I mean, Labor can't have it both ways, right? Labor is trying to suggest that we have cut too much, and at the same time is trying to say that we haven't cut enough. So, for example, on public hospital funding, Labor is running, or their supporters are running, advertising to say that we have cut $57 billion out of public hospitals. Well, I mean, the only difference between the coalition and the Labor Party now, when it comes to public hospitals, is $2 billion, which means that Labor now is supporting 96.5% of our savings of our decisions
figure,
to put our public hospital to put our public hospital funding growth trajectory on a more sustainable foundation.
You're using
for the future.
A 10-year figure and a 4-year figure,
well,
Mathias.
No, well, that's actually not true. Are you suggesting that you're putting more than $2 billion into public hospitals over the next 11 years?
$57 billion is a 10-year figure.
Are you telling us that you're putting in more than?
Okay, I'm sorry. We're going to.
Are you suggesting that you're putting in more than $2 billion over the next 11 years?
Do you realise the public is probably not aware of what you're talking about? So I'm going to go quickly to Alan Jones.
Well, I just make one point. It's 30 years since Paul Keating gave an interview on radio and said we're reaching, because of extraordinary levels of expenditure, we're reaching the status of a banana republic. Bob Hawke went off his head and said, you've just cost us the election. Paul Keating said, no, I haven't. I'm going to take the public into my confidence and explain to them what the problem is. And he did, and he cut $5.5 billion in 2 years of expenditure. That's equivalent to about $30 billion today, and he romped in. What is not happening here is we're treating the public as fools and imagining they don't understand. The questioner has highlighted what everybody is saying to me in correspondence. I'm worried about the debt. I'm worried about my kids having to inherit $500 billion of debt, which the current generation aren't prepared to pay for. Paul Keating did it 30 years ago. 10 years ago, Peter Costello said, today is a day when we've retired all debt. There was no debt 10 years ago. Here we are heading towards $500 billion of debt. And in a sense, both parties pretending they've got an answer to it, and they haven't.
OK, we're going to go to what is essentially one of the government's key answers to the economic problems. A question from Dominic Raffoux. And by the way, Dominic is the secretary of the McMahon branch of the Liberal Party. Clear disclosure. Where are you, Dominic? Go ahead.
Chris Murphy, an analyst commissioned by Treasury to forecast the economic impact of the Liberal government's corporate tax cut, has come out in favour of the policy, saying it is difficult to think of a government spending proposal that would offer such a high payoff ratio. He found that it would have a long-run cost to the budget of $3.7 billion a year and produce $8.9 billion in annual gross benefits to individuals. The Labor Party has heavily attacked the proposal as a $50 billion tax giveaway to large businesses. Is this simply another Labor Party scare campaign?
OK, once again, we'll start with The Economist. Chris Richardson, the $50 billion tax cut to business, large and small. Small business in the early stages, business in, big business in the later stage. Your assessment, first of all, as to the benefit to the economy.
Look, there are genuine benefits to the economy. Now, people don't get it. You know, $50 billion, company tax cut, they think, you know, welfare for the rich. And that makes the politics awful. But do bear with me for a moment, because the economics are very good. And Chris Murphy is quite right there. Why are you doing it? You know, and indeed, a bunch of it goes to foreigners, but that's the point. It's the foreigners you're trying to encourage to bring their money here. And their money then shows up as workers who are better equipped. You know, they have the better equipment, the better factories, mines, offices, shopping malls and the rest of it. And better equipped workers are more valuable workers. It spreads through. You know, it may start with the companies themselves, but it genuinely spreads through the economy. Now, not every economist agrees, but the bulk of the opinion is there, including Treasury itself. They're pretty clear that of the federal taxes, there are state taxes that are worse, but of the federal taxes, it's company tax, that hurts the economy the most. And if you can cut it, now, that obviously gives you more...
Chris, I'm going to have to jump around so we can hear from the other panellists. And Tanya Plibersek. We're hearing from The Economist the tax cut will be beneficial to the economy. We heard some figures up there.
OK. Treasury's modelling says that it'll be a 0.1% annual improvement starting in 10 years' time. So it's an improvement that rounds down to zero. We know that two-thirds of economists in a recent survey said we'd be better off spending the money on education because that will have a productivity benefit over time. If you look at the IMF, the OECD, all of them say that investing in education is something that will benefit our economy in the long run, individuals and our economy in the long run. And when we make big tax cuts like this, $50 billion, the Liberals have tried to claim our great reformer Paul Keating's imprimatur on this. Yes, Paul Keating made very substantial tax cuts, corporate tax cuts as well, but he dramatically broadened the tax base at the same time. The Liberals haven't told us what they're going to do to plug this $50 billion hole. Are they going to raise other taxes? Are they going to cut spending? Or are they going to increase the deficit? There's only three ways of paying for this $50 billion tax cut, and we don't know yet which of those three they're going to choose.
OK, Marcia, can I just hear from you on the $50 billion tax cut?
I agree that Australia has to radically cut its spending or the youngsters inherit an economic mess. Our debt's growing too fast. It's been growing too fast for the last 10 years. It's urgent, and I agree with Alan Jones for once in my life on this. The two parties have to be sensible about this. You know, this is a critical problem. And, you know, unfortunately, electoral politics disguise the seriousness of the problem from ordinary people who think that, you know, for instance, in a Farageist Brexit kind of way, that a tax cut to the corporates is somehow an assault on ordinary people, and that is not the case because, you know, when...
So do you accept the general principle that a tax cut to business will generate more jobs, more economic activity and be good for the economy?
It will, yes. That's what history tells us over and over again.
I've got to hear from Mathias Cormann. I'll come back to you, I promise.
I mean, we want individual Australians to be the most successful they can be. And in order to ensure that can happen, we need the businesses that employ them to be the most successful they can be. And what economists, what credible economists will tell you, including Dr. Ken Henry when he addressed the Labor Party Tax Forum back in 2011, the principal beneficiaries of a company tax cut are workers, because it will help boost investment, it will help boost productivity, it will help boost growth and help business create more jobs, employ more Australians, and it will help to increase real wages over time. Now, for Tanya's point that supposedly this is not paid for, it's just completely inaccurate. I mean, what we've set out very clearly in our budget is that we're paying for our company tax cut by cracking down on tax avoidance and by better targeting tax concessions and various other revenue measures. And if you look at our budget, what it'll show you is that we are projected to get to surplus by 2020-21 and to remain in surplus all the way through the medium term. So they are clearly paid for. Now, in relation
Not for 10 years, Mathias.
He was right back in 1993 when he said that a lower company tax rate will help attract investment, strengthen growth and create more jobs. He's wrong now when he says that it's unaffordable and he's wrong. I mean, he's supporting...
His argument, I think, was that you need to make cuts or raise revenue to pay for it.
Two points.
Firstly, Paul Keating in 1993 delivered a company tax cut from 39 to 33%, he actually narrowed the base. He didn't broaden the tax base. He delivered various measures, including the LAW tax cuts, which he then didn't follow through on
after the election. Let's not spend too much time in history. I think you've made your point.
But he also delivered a company tax cut at a time when he had a deficit of 4.1% as a share of GDP, about double the deficit.
I promise I'll go to Alan Jones on this.
Is going to pay for 10 years worth of tax cuts, not four.
It is absolutely paid for. The budget papers show
10 years? 10 years. No, your budget papers don't show 10 years.
They do show it.
I'm sorry. I'm going to throw to Alan Jones quickly.
You can't read budget papers. That is the problem.
Alan, keep it pretty sharp if you can.
I'll just make a point here that I think the polls indicate that the Labor Party have virtually come from nowhere, and Saturday is now very significant contest. I thought where the Labor Party lost direction was when they opposed company taxes, because people do understand...
Company tax cuts.
Yeah. People do understand. For example, it was Chris Boney's own book who said, it's a Labor thing to have the ambition of lowering the company tax because it provides investment, creates jobs and drives growth. That's what Malcolm Turnbull would be saying. Penny Wong, when she was finance minister, said, We understand that the cut in the corporate tax rate is important to increase productivity, to promote broad-based economic growth, and to encourage more investment and jobs across Australia. Now, there's no denying what Chris Richardson has said. The other most important point here, though, Tony, is that when, as Paul Keating demonstrated, when you cut the company tax rate, you are not foregoing revenue, you are increasing revenue. When the company tax rate was 49% of GDP, it turned in 2.5% of GDP in revenue. When Paul Keating then cut it to 39, the revenue rose to 3.1% of GDP. When he then cut it to 36, it rose to 3.4% of GDP. When it went to 30 cents in the dollar, it went to 4.6% of GDP. So Chris Richardson's point that you cut the company tax rate, you axiomatically are increasing productivity through extra jobs and so on. And that's where I thought, Tanya, Labor sort of lost direction.
You do get a response to that.
I think the Laffer curve is what you're talking about, isn't it, Chris? Is that what this theory is called? I think Ronald Reagan and Julie Bishop are fans of this economic theory that if you cut taxes, you collect more taxes.
Julia Gillard used to be a fan too.
What I can say...
If you're against company tax cuts, you're against jobs as well.
We just need to allow individuals to make their point.
It's a contentious proposition because when Ronald Reagan did it, he cut company taxes, and guess what? He collected less company tax. This proposition doesn't always work. And what it depends on is this proposition that if you cut taxes, you unleash the animal spirits and everybody will be better off because the benefits will trickle down to everyone. That has not been the experience overseas. We back a small business tax cut. We back a tax cut for genuinely small businesses, $2 million and under. That's more than 80% of Australian businesses. We also back targeted tax concessions to help small businesses hire new workers. We want people to be employing new workers. What we don't support is the $50 billion, $30 billion goes overseas, $7.4 billion goes to the big four banks. What, are they going to start reopening branches now? They're going to start employing more people branches. I mean, it is fanciful. Yes, you can support tax cuts when the budget can afford them. Are we going to add that $50 billion to the deficit? Are we going to add... are we going to cut spending by $50 billion or are we going to collect other taxes worth $50 billion?
The rate of tax for residents is a different issue from collecting taxes from foreign-based companies that are directing their taxes offshore to Singapore or other tax havens. They're two different issues and that muddies the waters.
I'm going to jump in because we could talk about the company tax cut forever. We've got a question. It's a video. It's from Will Cannier in New South Wales.
Virgin Wilson from Western New South Wales, Wilcannia. And Glenys Church from Western New South Wales, Wilcannia. A question to the panel is, when is government going to stop wasting taxpayers' money on funding a repetitive cycle that does not work and start listening to the community members who know the answers?
We need first to address basic human rights. The number one is housing. We need positions based here in order to work with our community on a needs basis, not outreach coming in weekly and monthly. Until this is addressed, domestic violence, drug and alcohol and mental health problems will continue.
Marcia, we'll start with you. We have heard very little about Indigenous affairs. Here's a couple of voices from the ground in Wilcannia. What do you say?
Well, thank you, Virgin, and Glenys, is it?
Yes.
So... I agree, housing is the critical issue for most Aboriginal communities. The state social housing models have got it wrong. On the other hand, you know, it's pretty bad in some areas and it's not so bad in other areas. The problem is having jobs growth, dealing with violence, as you say, making sure kids go to school every day, all of these policy settings have to be right. Governments mostly wimp out on it, but I think it takes strong women's voices like your own to keep driving this point home. I understand from when I was working with Andrew Forrest and the team from Prime Minister and Cabinet on the Jobs and Training Review that there were 150 NGOs in Wilcannia. So what are they doing there? You're right to say that local solutions are better than all of these outreach organisations visiting your community. It's a complete waste of money to spend so much money on NGOs. This is where investment in education is important. Invest in the education of the Wilcannia children and don't give the money to the NGOs.
Can I just ask you quickly, why is it you think that during this election campaign we've heard very little, if anything, about Indigenous issues?
Oh, Tony. I've been watching elections for 50 years and it's the same old answer. Everybody wants Aborigines to shut up during the election because both sides of politics, and I'm not even talking about the Greens here, there's no point, but, you know, both sides of politics don't want a backlash from, you know, the racist backblocks. You know, so if they say too much, the racists are going to say, well, I'm not voting for them. They're backing those lazy Aborigines. But I have to say, there have been a couple of policies that have quietly been inserted into the slipstream. The $90 million for Indigenous enterprise development and the policy that goes with that, that's pretty good. And I'm pretty pleased with the Coalition's policy on family violence. However, I'm very worried about some, you know, that game that the Spivs play with three cups. There's been a bit of that going on. First, last year there was a $90 million...
Pee under the cup.
Yeah, the pee under the cup game. $90 million invested by the government into domestic violence campaigns. Some proportion of that was supposed to be for preventing violence against Indigenous women, which ranges between 34 times the national figures to, you know, in the worst areas, 80 times. Mm. So, you know, it's a high priority issue. The numbers of women that we're losing to murder and assault are just shocking. Then the money was taken out to be given to medical services, and now another 25 mil has been slipped in, and everybody's worried that that's going to go to the legal services. The blunt instrument of representing people in court, if all the money goes to the legal services, will not solve the problem. We need the money to go to services to stop the violence. Now, yes, that can
be... services run by the communities, as those two women were suggesting?
It has to be absolute subsidiarity, as close as possible to the problem. So, therefore, we need much more... This needs to be a COAG issue. We need much more encouragement in the by the Commonwealth, in the jurisdictions, to train police, train the courts and train the public prosecutor's staff to deal with these issues seriously. We've seen a number of cases recently. The Daly case and the Ms. Du case in Western Australia. The police couldn't have behaved more appallingly in the Ms. Du case. The public prosecutor in New South Wales, that history is just incomprehensible.
Marcia, can I just interrupt you because we've got people watching this on Facebook. We've got a question coming in on Facebook from William Robert Fisher. What about Bill Shorten's mention of a treaty? I guess that was one of the times when Indigenous affairs did make headlines.
Yeah, for all the wrong reasons. So, I think it was about early 2011 that Julia Gillard appointed the expert panel on constitutional recognition of Indigenous Australians. The report was handed to her, and we've heard nothing substantial since from either party, although both parties say that they're committed to it. But no response, no adequate response in any of the detail. Now, I think we're up to our fifth committee. You know, if you don't want to do something in politics, you send the problem off to a commission for the future. We've had five of them on this issue so far. We now have the referendum council.
So, very, very quick answer on this one. Treaty...
Why raise a treaty when, you know, you've spent so much money on the constitutional recognition problem and we're still waiting for an answer and there's a referendum council sitting there, you know, to do its work with the idea of coming up with a referendum question, the timing of the referendum, you know, all the technicalities for the referendum, and somebody throws the treaty bomb in. Mm. Why? Well, why do that?
Tony asked him. That's why.
Actually, he someone from him. The floor asked. Asked him, and I pressed him for an answer, as it happens.
He is back in
Alan Jones.
Well, if he had given my answer, I would have been much more confident in the whole process. Instead, he said, yes, let's have a treaty. Oh, no, please.
He's not a slave to questions. He could answer as he thinks.
I think to be fair to Bill Shorten, he has backed away from that since. Marcia, I think one of the problems with that, to take your first point, and I agree with you, it's life. There's bureaucracy everywhere. And your point about 150 NGOs in Wilcannia is a scandal. All this money goes to Indigenous Australia and it's swallowed up by white bureaucrats, and I think people are tired of that. On the treaty thing, all I'd say is that I don't think Australia quite understands what the word is about. What is meant by a treaty? I mean, the Treaty of Waitangi, of course, was established between the Maoris and the British long before New Zealand settlement, but people don't quite understand what is intended with a treaty. And as you say, I think we're moving on the constitutional recognition issue, and now a spanner's been thrown into the works here, but I think Bill Shorten has backed away from that.
Well, I don't think the two are mutually exclusive. We can absolutely have a bipartisan support
for
constitutional...
But what do you mean by a treaty?
I'm just saying we can have bipartisan support for constitutional recognition and say, once we have achieved constitutional recognition, we can keep talking about treaty. Achieving constitutional recognition doesn't rule out discussion
about
the next
thing.
Well, it's not for me to say today, right now. This is, can we have this conversation as a nation?
See, that's what Marcia said.
Can I just pick up on something else that Marcia said? The reason she said that we don't tend to discuss Indigenous affairs in elections is because it raises in the back blocks the spectre of racism, of people saying, let's not talk about Aborigines, let's not give them any more. What do you say? Why do you think it slips below the radar during election campaigns?
Well, if you just take the Indigenous component out of it, I think you'd find people west of the Great Dividing Range say that they don't count. There are no votes. I mean, you take Queensland, for example, 2/3 of Queensland is represented by 3 people in the parliament. I mean, I get letters every day from people west of the Great Dividing Range. Just the other day when the New South Wales budget was brought down, people are writing to me, say, I'll tell you what NSW stands for, Newcastle, Sydney and Wollongong. You know, if you're west of the Great Dividing Range, you don't count. And this is that's why they call it the back blocks. You are in the back blocks and you are forgotten.
So you would deny that there's any kind of hint of racism?
Think people are terrified of all of that, yes. Terrified of confronting the reality. And the reality is all Australians are entitled to be treated with taxpayers' money with the dignity that we'd expect every Australian to enjoy. And that doesn't happen with a lot of Australians.
All right, we're going to move on because we've got quite a few things to talk about. Remember, it's an election campaign. If you have any doubtful claims, send a tweet using the hashtags FactCheck and Quanda. Keep an eye on our Twitter account for the verdicts from the ABC FactCheck Unit and the conversations academics. Our next question comes from Jeff Morris.
Mr. Cormann, 8 years ago, I became the whistleblower in the Commonwealth Bank financial planning scandal. The subsequent Senate inquiry of 2014 found that your tough cop, ASIC, was a timid and hesitant regulator and recommended a royal commission into the Commonwealth Bank. Many more financial scandals have taken place since then, all of them on ASIC's watch, and yet your government still refuses to call a royal commission. Yet at the same time, your government also takes millions of dollars in political donations from those same banks. So my question to you, Mr. Cormann, is how can this possibly be right?
Well, we think it's very important that if any bank or any financial services institution does anything wrong, that effective action is taken, and that is why we've provided additional powers and resources to ASIC. You're right. I mean, there have been a series of inquiries. There's been a Senate inquiry. We've had the Financial Systems Inquiry. In our judgment, having more inquiries and just continuing to look at issues without actually having the capacity to take effective action is not the best way forward. We've taken action. We've given additional resources to ASIC. We've responded to the recommendations that have been made by various inquiries. In our judgment, it was time for action, not time for yet another inquiry that essentially would not be able to do anything about what it finds. If you look at what happened in terms of the Trade Union Royal Commission, that actually investigated facts that could not otherwise be investigated because the previous Labor government abolished the Australian Building and Construction Commission, a regulator that we want to bring back. But when it comes to the financial services sector, there is a regulator, and that regulator is ASIC, and we've worked to make that regulator more effective, give it more powers and more resources.
Mathias, can I just go back to our questioner? Well, you've heard the answer. Do you want a follow-up question?
Well, I would say that if ASIC really was a tough cop, none of these scandals would have happened in the first place. And I would also say that we've seen what a Royal Commission can achieve through the Royal Commission into Child Abuse. And for $53 million, less than one-third the cost of the pointless plebiscite on marriage equality, you could have a Royal Commission into the banks.
Well, I mean, many of the events that you talk about, of course, were happening in the period of the previous Labor governments, and some of them actually during the period when Bill Shorten was the Financial Services Minister. So since then, there have been a whole series of inquiries. There has been a response by government. Government has provided additional resources and additional powers to ASIC, and our judgment is that is the best way
forward.
Let's
hear from the other politician involved in this, because Labor is obviously calling for a Royal Commission.
We do support a Royal Commission because every time we hear there's a scandal, the banks say, oh, we're all over it, we've fixed it, it won't happen again, and then there's the next scandal, the next one unfolds. We've heard such horrendous stories. I'm not going to repeat them all tonight, but the one that stayed with me was the fellow that was denied health insurance because he had, I quote, the wrong type of heart attack. This is really a systemic problem that needs a thorough systemic evaluation.
Alan Jones, a brief comment, if you wouldn't mind.
Well, I think the questioner is 100% correct. At a personal level, I can't tell you how many battles I've had with the banks over farmers. I've gone to Winton, where farmers have never missed a payment and they've been moved off their properties. No sympathetic hearing from them, nothing. The whole terms of the loans have been altered. Then you've got this ridiculous business where financial planners working for the banks are recommending products to customers of the bank when the financial planner has an interest, a beneficial interest in the advice that he's giving, and they go broke as a result of the advice. Now, look, John Williams, Senator from New South Wales, Liberal Senator, called for a Royal Commission. I mean, you don't do these things lightly, but quite frankly, nothing is happening, Mathias. This is a very, very serious issue. Decent people are being thrown under buses.
I've got to move on. I'm sorry. We could stick with that one for a long time. We've got another question, completely different one from Daniel Cowan.
Yes, my question relates to housing affordability and tax reform. My question is for the Coalition, Minister Foreman. My question relates to the fact I work with first-time buyers every day and the struggles are real in terms of them being priced out of the market. Only last week on Hack Live on ABC, we found there was an investor sitting next to a first-time buyer and the investor found it easier to go and buy their 201st property than a first-time buyer could get their first property. Then we see that first-time buyers are at all-time lows while investor activity is at all-time highs. So my question is, why is the Liberal Party doing nothing to help first-time buyers? If you don't agree with the reforms from the Labor Party, why not come up with reforms of your own?
Well, firstly, the best way to increase housing affordability is to increase supply of housing. And, of course, the worst thing that you would do if you want to increase the supply of housing is to reduce the level of investment. I mean, Labor's negative gearing policy, a range of economists have now clearly pointed out, would drive down the value of existing homes. It would increase the cost of rental accommodation. It would distort investment in the property market. But, like, if it was really about housing affordability, why is Labor proposing to remove negative gearing from investment in shares, in small business, in commercial property and the like? So what we would say negative gearing, if you look at what it actually is, it enables people to leverage the value of their existing home and their existing income to invest in income-producing or appreciating assets. And that is the way families around Australia have gone ahead for a very long time. Now, whether these are investments in a small business, whether these are other investments. Now, what Labor is proposing is to indiscriminately to indiscriminately remove that opportunity and to say you can only use it when you invest in new housing developments. Now, that means that there will be more competition for first home buyers when they want to buy a new house. So we don't believe it's a well thought out property. The issue of housing affordability is real, and the way to deal with it is to ensure, working together with state and territory governments in particular, that we free up the release of land, that we increase the supply of housing, not by reducing the level of investment going into the housing market.
Chris Richardson, let's hear from an economist again. What's your view on, on the removal of these particularly negative gearing, but also the lowering of capital gains tax, which fueled the housing investment market?
I really don't think that will make a big difference to housing affordability. What is driving the affordability or lack of it in housing is because interest rates have never been lower. You can argue whether it's 2,000 years, 5,000 years. And when the cost of money goes down, the value of stuff goes up. So all over the world, you know, whether it's housing in Sydney or indeed share markets, you know, all over the world, stuff has gone up. Taxes won't change that. They really won't. You know, state governments and supply can help. What I would love to see done on the policy front is sawing in half, taking half of Labor's policy and half of the coalition's. Two things on the tax. Negative gearing has a terrible reputation, but economists will tell there is nothing wrong with that. If you spend money to make money, that's deductible and should be in any system. We used to have negative gearing barely used in Australia. Back when the other half of this equation, the capital gains tax discount was lower. We give too big a discount to capital gains, so everybody tries to throw their money into housing or whatever it may be, and that's why they end up using negative gearing. You could have better policies in Australia, and it's almost exactly halfway between both parties, and even then, it's not going to solve housing affordability.
So quickly go back to our questioner, Chris. Do you take that point? I mean, do you have a particular view about negative gearing, capital gains tax, or both of them?
Well, I agree that the Labor's proposal might not necessarily be the full answer to help housing affordability, and I agree that existing homeowners, like the first-time buyers, shouldn't just be able to get in the market because prices fall off a cliff. That's not going to be the right solution either. But, I mean, the Liberal Party in their very first budget, which was Hockey was Treasurer, they removed the first-home savers account, so they reduced support, and that was trying to help first-home buyers put a deposit together, which is arguably the hardest part of being a first-home buyer is putting the deposit together. So the Liberal Party removed the first-home savers account that the Labor Party put in.
Okay.
Well, the advice was there was a very, very, very low take-up rate. It was completely unpopular and people didn't access it. That's why we removed it.
Okay, let's go to Tanya Plibersek, first of all, on Labor's policy, because it's been discussed here.
Well, I'll come back to you, Joe Hockey said in his last speech to the Parliament that we should do something about negative gearing and capital gains tax. He was worried about the excesses. Scott Morrison, before he became the Treasurer, talked about the excesses in the system. We believe that it's unfair that you get more help to buy your 10th, 20th, 200th house than you do to get your first house, and we do want to make it a bit easier for first home buyers. We're worried about the social effects of a generation of young Australians being locked out of home ownership. Home ownership is really important when you want to establish a family. You want to, if you possibly can, have paid off a home by the time you're retiring, so that if you are living on the pension, you're not paying rent as well. So we think it is very important, and by making these changes, nobody who's currently got a negatively geared property is affected. In the middle of next year, if we're successful, yes, we will direct new investment into new construction. That means that we'll actually see an increase in construction. 26,000 extra jobs we anticipate from that increase in construction, so it has that additional benefit as well. We're worried about the social problems that come with locking young people out of the first home market, and we want to give them a chance to compete. We know at the moment that about 96% of investor loans go to established properties, and so we're not doing anything to improve the amount of housing available if we're just pushing up the price of existing properties.
Alan, briefly again, because we're going to move on to our next question.
I mean, this is a really serious issue because and I noticed the age of the questioner, which is very significant. I mean, young people coming out of tertiary education face a HECS debt. They've got to retire the HECS debt. They've got to pay rent. They've got to try and save a deposit. It's almost impossible. Almost impossible. I despair for those people, and this has to be seriously addressed. The other thing I would just say is we've got people watching this program now who are shovel ready. They are ready to build extra stock, and you've got bureaucracies, to come back to Marcia's point, you've got bureaucracies who are preventing it. We need more stock. We need to get people out there to build homes. That makes them cheaper, but it doesn't overcome the problem that how do you pay off your HECS debt, how do you pay your rent, and how do you save a deposit before the bank's even interested in you? It's a big, big issue.
OK, it's time to move on. Our next question comes from John Armstrong.
This is for Tanya Plibersek. Tanya, referring to Labor Party's Medicare campaign, what hard evidence do you have that the coalition's planning to destroy Medicare, or is this just another desperate pre-election gambit?
Well, we've got 40 years of evidence. We first introduced Medibank and the Fraser government privatised it. We introduced Medicare and we fought to defend it, protect it and expand it for 40 years. When this government first came in, they tried to introduce a $7 GP co-payment. Then they tried to increase the cost of every prescription by $5. Now they've got rid of the bulk billing incentive for diagnostic imaging and blood tests, so you'll have to pay more every time you get a blood test or an X-ray. They've frozen the Medicare benefits schedule, which Tony Shepherd has agreed on one of your ABC programs, is a backdoor way of introducing a GP co-payment, because when you freeze the amount that doctors are paid for 6 years, then they will have to charge patients. Patients will have to pay a co-payment. At every opportunity, the Liberals are trying to get you to put your hand in your pocket, and that is what a privatised American-style health system looks like. Now, that's in addition to the fact that they have farmed out the cancer register, they're trying to farm out the vaccine register, they're trying to farm out the back office work of Medicare. That's additional to all of those user pays changes that they've tried to introduce to our health system.
OK, Mathias Cormann.
Labor was called out, Bill Shorten was called out for the desperate lie that this proposition was that we somehow were going to privatise Medicare. The coalition will not privatise Medicare. There never was a plan to privatise Medicare, and none other than the national president of the IMA called Bill Shorten's lie out. It's because they don't have anything to say about the economy and jobs that they've got to go and resort to this sort of desperate scare campaign. Now, Medicare is in very good shape. Bulk billing rates are higher than they were under the Labor Party, and indeed...
Is it in good enough shape to unfreeze doctors' fees, for example?
Well, the thing is, you see, you can't have it both ways. So we've had a conversation at the beginning of this discussion about the need for savings and getting the budget back onto a more sustainable foundation for the future. And when we make a saving...
So, hang on, that question, though, is it in good enough shape to unfreeze doctors' fees? Because the fear that people have is that if you keep them frozen...
Yeah.
They'll put the fees up.
Well, I was about to answer your question. If we were to unfreeze it from 1 July 2016, that would mean another 56 cents per visit for GPs. We're saying that, we can have a saving which helps the budget bottom line, which helps us pay for $2.9 billion in additional investment for state public hospitals, which helps us pay for $1 billion in additional payments through the pharmaceutical benefit scheme to pay for affordable access to cancer treatment drugs and the like. We are able to continue the freeze, which Labor started. So when Labor started the freeze in the indexation of MBS rebates, it was fine.
Okay,
when
super
the coalition
quickly,
very quick response. Response.
Very quick.
Super quickly, we realigned the dates that we changed payments by 7 months, and you were going for 6 years, Mathias. 7 months, 6 years, a bit different. But when I was the health minister, I made savings in the health system as well. I made savings by means testing private health insurance. You opposed that, Mathias. And I made savings by paying less for generic drugs, also opposed by the Liberals. So, yes, it is important that every single health dollar is well spent, but you don't do it by hurting patients and you don't do it by moving us to an American-style...
Can I just pause both of you? Because...
By moving to
Marcia
American
said
health system.
She wanted to make a quick response to this. Yeah. We've got to move on to another question, okay. So make it very quick.
The computer system that was established for the payment system was a part of the debate. And both sides have now backed off from modernising that computer system. It cannot cope with the...
$31 billion.
Yeah, $31 billion in payments. Mm. We need a modern computer system. We need a modern payment system. We are moving rapidly into the e-health digital delivery of health services. This is tremendously important for a country like ours, with scattered populations across our vast country. For instance, Telstra even has its own Telstra Health digital service now. This is becoming increasingly common. We need to modernise the payment system for Medicare as a matter of urgency, and it is very unfortunate, I think, for our country that's been taken off the table because of the
It hasn't been taken off the table exactly, because Malcolm Turnbull says that you're going to do it within government, correct?
We will be modernising
the payment system. We heard the answer to that from the Prime Minister the other day. OK, there's time for one last question. It comes from Elijah Gibbons.
Approximately 75% of British citizens under 25 years old voted against Brexit in the recent EU referendum, but they were outweighed by the larger and more conservative older generations. This event parallels how the opinions of the Australian youth are treated in regards to marriage equality and immigration. As the youth of Australia will ultimately be the ones most affected, how can we ensure that the voices of the future can be heard?
Tanya Plibersek, start with you.
Well, I'm so glad you're here tonight to ask that question. That's a really good start. I think it's... a lot of people say that young people are disengaged from politics. I have exactly the opposite experience. I think young people are really engaged. They might not be joining political parties in the way that I did when I was your age, but they're involved in issues. And I think campaigning on issues with people that you share views with is a really important first step. Making your voice heard to your local Member of Parliament, make an appointment to see your federal Member of Parliament. We all have... street stalls and all sorts of opportunities to be approached on the street or in our offices to talk. You can do that anytime. You can be involved in internet kind of driven campaigns as well. I think that I have a lot of faith and a lot of hope in the next generation of young Australian political activists, because I see great ones all the time.
Alan Jones, can I just bring up something? You quoted social media yourself just a short time ago. This is a tweet after the Brexit vote from a young Briton. I'm so angry, a generation given everything, free education, golden pension, social mobility, have voted to strip my generation's future.
Mm. Well, I don't think that's the case, but I can understand the sentiment. And I agree with Tanya's comment. The youth are tomorrow, and I think it's absolutely essential we hear the views of youth and we understand them and we talk to them. At the end of the day, that was a democratic process in relation to Brexit. If I thought you were talking about marriage equality, so if we're saying to step on what sometimes is controversial territory, and it hasn't come up tonight, but let me nail my colours to the mast, I'm certainly opposed to a plebiscite on this issue. And I think that when Bill Shorten made his observations about that, and he argued that a plebiscite would be homophobic, that's not what he was saying. I think he said there must be ways in which we can avoid the kind of exchanges that would occur if a plebiscite took place. Malcolm Turnbull himself was in favour of a vote of the Parliament. Indeed, he represented that view to me when he was the Minister for whatever it was, NBN or something, before he became Prime Minister. And I think it would be very unfortunate if we went down a track where we've spent a whole heap of money and had people throwing insults at one another from both sides of the equation.
Is the Brexit vote a bit of a warning there? Because it became so divisive.
Yes, Brexit was divisive. The division, though, derives from Cameron. I mean, Cameron actually thought...
No, let's go there. I'm just wondering if that's if you can draw some reasons why you should be wary of a plebiscite.
Well, I think David Cameron actually called the referendum because he thought he'd win it easily. Yeah. That was the point. It was an error of judgment. But I think here you do have to try to avoid, on major issues such as that, the kind of divisiveness that we saw over there. And I'll just make one final point. I mean, there are 23 million people in Australia. They can't all sit in the federal parliament. So we elect 150 in the House of Representatives to represent those 22 million people on critical issues such as this. I think we should do what Malcolm Turnbull originally said we should do, let the parliament decide.
So briefly, it worries you that...
It certainly worries me. I think that... I think a lot of the young people are worried. I get a stack of correspondence about this. They're very concerned about the direction that this could take us. And I think we can avoid, we can do without all of that.
Chris Richardson, so it's a question about the future of young people, or you can pick up on whichever element of it you like.
So, Tony, there are a lot of young people in the audience tonight, and I'm glad that you're upset and engaged about a bunch of things. And what continues to stun me is that young people are not angrier about a bunch of things going on in our budget. The key unfairness in our budget is that it is too much in favour of the old. You know, the superannuation rules, the capital gains taxes, we don't put the family home in the pensions assets test.
Debt.
And the deficits, exactly, Alan. You know, here am I, very comfortably well off. Australia has just had a quarter of a century of economic growth uninterrupted, best we've ever done, second best the world's ever seen, and we keep saying, thank you, you will be paying for all these services I'm getting and for many years to come. Be angrier about that. This nation can and should be better than that.
Mathias Cormann.
Well, let me echo the sentiment. We need young people to be involved, and we need as many young people as possible to be involved and be interested in our future, because that means that you will support our policies which are designed to help young people to get ahead. I mean, at the end of the day, everything we're trying to do when we focus on strengthening growth, creating more jobs, it's about helping young people have the best possible opportunity to be successful and to get ahead. When we focus on getting the budget on a sustainable foundation for the future, we want to ensure that today's generation doesn't live at your expense. So we do need more young people to be actively involved, actively interested, and to share your views.
Very briefly, the sentiment expressed by Alan Jones here that the plebiscite on same-sex marriage could be dangerously divisive. Brief answer.
Well, I support the plebiscite. The Parliament has dealt with this issue on a number of occasions, and on each occasion has supported the current definition of marriage in the Marriage Act. We've made a decision that in order to resolve this issue on a more permanent basis, to put it to the Australian people. In a democracy, when there's a diversity of views, when there is strongly held views on both sides of the argument, the fairest way to resolve that issue is at the ballot box, and that is what we're proposing to do.
But, Tony, not even the Cabinet will be bound to vote in the way the plebiscite finds. So we're going to spend $160 million, and if the answer is yes, half the Cabinet can still vote no.
That is correct.
Mathias, it's a very expensive opinion poll.
Well, I mean, as with any democratic exercise, and we've seen it in the United Kingdom the other week, I would not want to preempt the outcome, but let me assure you that whatever the outcome of the plebiscite will be carried by the Parliament. I'm very confident of that.
OK. Marcia Langton, I'd actually like to throw that question to you, but if I could get you to reflect on what all of that means for Indigenous young people.
Well, on Saturday, young people should turn out to vote. Why did the Leave Party or the Leave advocates win in England? Because the young didn't turn out to vote. They thought it was all right to stay at home and not vote. Turn up and vote.
I'm just going to make one point. I think it's correct to say that 57% of the Indigenous population are under 25, compared to, I think it's 30-something percent for the rest of the country.
That's right. Most of our population, the Indigenous population, are under 25. It's about 60% are under 25. So, you know, it's kind of the opposite with the rest of the population. The young, for most Australians, the young will be supporting the old, cannot afford to. This is the big long-term economic problem. The young can't afford to support the old. In our community, we have a huge number of young people, mostly young people, but their problem is that many of them are undereducated and not capable of earning a decent income by joining the workforce. And so because there are such education and employment gaps, They're actually worse off than my generation in many ways. So, you know, and be engaged. I worry for young Australians because I think when, even though I tilted at windmills when I was young, and that's normal. You know, they say if you don't tilt at windmills when you're young, you don't have a heart. But if you don't face up to reality when you're older, you're not using your head. But I do worry that there are far too many tilting at windmill ideas floating around amongst the younger population in Australia. And I think you should all read and be very well informed because there are some crazy ideas out there that really, I think, are misleading you. So I would like to see young people go to school every day, turn up and vote, look forward to a good job and a good career. There's a view that you don't have to do any of those things that's taken hold of too many people, especially in my community, especially through drug use and so on. I think we have to be very hard-headed about that. You will have a miserable life if you don't get an education.
That's actually a perfect place for us to leave it. In fact, all we have time for tonight. Please thank our panel, Tanya Plibersek, Alan Jones, Marcia Langton, Mathias Cormann and Chris Richardson. Now, next weekend, the votes will have been counted. Q&A will be back on Monday with the Minister for Resources and Energy, Josh Frydenberg, Shadow Treasurer, Chris Bowen, South Australian Green Senator, Sarah Hanson-Young, the Editor-at-Large for The Australian, Paul Kelly. Until next week's Q&A, good night.